station, UHF TV 33, Detroit Highland Park.
Good afternoon. This is Brenda Perryman, and I'm bringing you Talk to Me with Brenda Perryman, the Brenda Perryman Show, today on TV 33 WHPR. And I think we have a nice opening for you, if my engineer is ready. Okay, and you can, today is a very, very special day because you're watching TV 33 WHPR, Detroit and Highland Park. And if you choose to call us today, which I think you might choose to call us, you could call us at 313-868-0342, 313-868-0351, and 313-868-4336. If you want to get us on the web, of course you can at www.tv33whpr.com. Okay, I got an intro for you.
I just wanna take a little time out. Thank you, baby.
That's the
thank you for your love.
Everyone, as I told you, we're remembering my friend and my guest husband, Mr. Ronald Dean Banks of the Dramatics. And I have Sandy with me. And Sandy, straight is going to be fine. I just wanted a special intro for this show. And as you know, we're coming up to the end of the first year anniversary of the passing of Ron. And I thought it was only appropriate to do a special tribute out here. I have Sandy Banks. I have his best friend, Harley. He'll be up here shortly. And some other surprises for you. Sandy.
Yes.
Thank you so much. I know how it is. You could slide in a little bit. As we come up on this time, and you know, you have such precious memories. When you think of Ron, what do you think of first?
Ron the man.
Absolutely. Ron the man. Yeah.
The father, the dad, the husband.
Right. And I know you guys had so many good times, isn't that right?
Absolutely.
And what sticks out in your mind? What happy time sticks out in your mind when you first think about him?
Probably my surprise proposal, engagement, marriage, all in one day.
All in one day. Why don't you tell us all about that?
Ron was on tour. He was on the West Coast at the time. And it was planned that all the wives was going to fly into Vegas. Uh-huh. Unbeknownst to me, in a few days, it was going to be my wedding day. He played at the Hollywood Hard Rock Cafe in Vegas, mm-hmm. brought me on stage, sang Lady in Red, got down on one knee, and proposed. Next day, it was a whirlwind. We had, went with me, found a dress. You know, he had made all the arrangements. That's what made it so beautiful. He made the arrangements beforehand. All I had to do was say yes, and wow. I did.
He was always kind of special like that, yeah. That twinkle in his eye and everything, and just wanted to make people happy. So after you got married, like you say, you didn't know this was going to happen.
Not
right?
at all. No. And Ron really can't keep secrets, so.
For him to keep that secret.
It was a big secret.
It was a big deal, a big secret.
And I'm nosy.
Well, I know that you all have children.
Yes.
How many do you have?
We have 8 altogether, 6 girls, 2 boys.
And then there's Tanya.
Tanya, she's included in that.
Oh, I know she is. She's a wonderful young lady. Why don't you name your children?
Well, this my daughter from a previous is Cherie, and then it's Tanya. That was Vicky is her mom. And then me and Ron's children together is Bianca, Brianna, Ronald, Bridget, those are twins, and Raymond. Brandy. Got Brandy.
Okay, can't forget Brandy.
Can't forget Brandy.
Well, someone's calling us already. Do you mind if I answer?
No, go ahead.
Okay. Good afternoon. Hello? Hello?
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, could
hi.
You?
Hi. Can you hear me?
Yes, can you turn down your radio or TV?
Okay, is it a little better now?
Yes.
You said it's better?
Yes.
Okay. I have a few questions that I'd like to ask your guest. I was at the funeral of Ron Banks, and I still have the obituaries and the small picture obituary that is the Ron Banks Foundation. And I was so hurt that he died as the second lead singer of the Dramatics. I really enjoyed his music as a child. And I think it's sad that our music industry doesn't give a lot of credit to the Dramatics, except for when it comes to movies where they'll play some of their older hits or new recordings if it comes with the different rappers.
Right.
I think that they're not giving enough justice.
And
but it was interesting. This was the first time I ever seen a funeral such as that and seeing Ron Banks. But when I was looking at the obituary, I didn't understand. I know that Ron had been married previous, and it shows you a brief picture of his first wife and his first I didn't understand, when you read the obituary, her name is put last when she was the firstborn. Her name should have been put first.
Well, I don't think that's really that important right now.
It may not be, but that's something that
I can't make that recall in there. And if that happened, and you can imagine going upstairs and finding your husband dead, my world collapsed. And if that happened, as you said it did, there was not a reason for it to happen like that, other than it was a mistake.
Okay, and your next quick one, because the phone is lighting up.
Yeah, I just wanted to know, why was her name put...
Oh, well, she doesn't know. She really doesn't.
I had a lot of people helping me with the obituary. As you can see, there were over 4,000 people there. So it was a lot of stuff going on. And me personally, I couldn't think one moment to the next. I tried to do the best I could. Tanya knows I love her. And there was no slight on Tanya.
Not at all. Not at all. So thank you for your call. Thank you. Hello? Good afternoon. We'll try the next line. Hello. Good afternoon.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Hi, Sandy. This is Ruby Mott from Facebook.
Oh, hi, Ruby. Did you see me break down?
I'm blessing you.
I'm doing pretty good, Ruby.
I have a question for you.
Okay.
Is there a particular song of Ron and the Dramatics that you have has special meaning to you, and what is it?
If I had to choose
what's your favorite?
Lady in Red, because that's what he proposed to me on. Lady in Red, and that was his favorite too.
Oh, okay.
Yes, he redid it.
One of mine too.
Is it really?
Yes.
Yeah.
Oops. I think all of them are my favorites. Yes.
They're classic.
Yes, they are.
Okay, thank you.
Talk to you soon, Ruby.
All right.
Bye bye. Good afternoon. Hello?
Hi, it's Tanya Banks.
Hi, Tanya. How you doing? This is Ron's firstborn, Tanya Banks, and we're just talking about her. And
did you hear the question, Tanya? The first question?
No, I just heard you say Lady in Red was your favorite song.
Oh, okay. Well, don't worry about that.
Love you.
Tanya, I'm so happy you got a chance to call in and our listeners can hear you. Your Uncle Harley Brown is here also.
Hi, Uncle Harley.
He'll be on in a few minutes. He'll be on shortly. But Tanya, when you think of your dad, what is your favorite memory of your dad?
There's so many. It's hard to pick just one. But I think what I loved about my father is that how he could walk into a room and the whole place would just light up. He just had that effect on me and everybody around us. And, you know, what I love about him is that he would come in and he didn't meet a stranger. So whomever he was talking to, everybody was his best friend. And it taught me that that's how, you know, you're supposed to go out and be with people, because no matter, you know, he was on Soul Train and seen all around the world, he was still just a guy from around the way.
And that's something that Sandy said earlier. He just was a regular guy.
He was. And you know, he loved to entertain, but I think the other thing is he was just a people person.
Didn't you say that?
Yes, absolutely. She knows her dad better than anybody, and he truly stood for that. She can remember going to the store, and a fan would stop him. How long would you have to stand there while your dad talked to one of his fans?
He had to stand and smile, too. Yeah, whether he knew him for, like, you know, 20 years or for
just met
that
him.
Minute, yes. They would have a conversation.
Right, right.
And, I mean, he just talked. And like you said, when you meet him, it's like you knew him for a long time. And, Tanya, I remember when he used to ride you on the back of that bike when you were a very little girl, like 2 and 1 and everything, to ride you down the street.
Oh, yeah. You know what's funny about it? I mean, again, when you talk about him, he could easily have been a father that, you know, busy, but he took time for all of us. And when you talk about remembering him riding with the bike, he loved to be there to train or, you know, to show us something. So I also remember the first time I did learn how to ride my bike, and Daddy was teaching me. And at the same time, one of our neighbors, she was learning, her father was teaching her. And at the same time, they said, go. And so we hit each other. So they said, well, we got to start that again. Or y'all gotta
which
go
neighbor was way. That? Which neighbor? Which neighbor was that?
That would have been Rhonda, Rhonda Tate.
Right, right across the street, right around a few doors from you, right?
Yep.
Right, right. And so now that when you think of your dad, and I know it has to bring a smile to your face now, right?
Absolutely. Oh, yeah. I think about him often.
And also, tell the story that you told me. Because I know you don't have a long time, but I want you to tell the story about when you were at that banquet and someone said you were his daughter.
Yeah, and I was actually attending, it was a Black press event in Washington, D.C. And, you know, honestly, I had gone with some friends just, you know, trying to enjoy myself. And it was right around about a year ago when Daddy had passed. So just, you know, trying to get out and about. And sort of the word it got around that I was there and that I was Ron Banks' daughter. And in the middle of the banquet, Joe the Eagle, the radio announcer.
Joe Madison? Said, you know,
Joe Madison.
He's from Detroit, too.
He said, you know, we just want to acknowledge we have Ron Banks' daughter here, and we just want to, you know, acknowledge her presence because we all love Ron. He was there for the Black media and did so much for the community. And the whole room stood up, and I got a standing ovation.
Wow. I remember you telling me that.
And it was just awesome. I was like, Daddy is still working around me.
Sounds like him, Tanya.
Yeah, he had just said that he and Al Sharpton had talked to him about some of the things he was doing in school and in the community. And so, you know, they had just spoken with him. But yet again, that's an example of how he would just touch so many people.
Right, right. Well, I thank you so much for calling in, and we have such, I wish, are you able to see the show on the internet?
Yes, I can stream it, so I'll continue to pull it up.
Okay, because I got some little surprises coming. So thank you, sweetheart, and tell Vicky hello and
I
everything.
Will. And I just, you know, thank you, and thank you all for remembering my dad.
Of course, and when you come to town, we all got to get together.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Call me tonight, Tanya. Love you.
Okay. Love you, Tanya. Bye-bye. Wow.
She's special. She Ron is. Was so proud.
Harvard University,
yes, ma'am.
Northwestern University.
And yes,
but
ma'am.
He was proud of all the children.
Yeah.
All the children, because the last time he came by, it was about Brianna. I get them all mixed up. Wanted her to go, you know, checking on schools for
right,
her.
Right, right.
And tell the audience about the educational program he was involved in.
Well, 'cause
he really seemed to like that.
Oh, that was his next career. The last 2 years of Ron's life, he met a man named Jim Hare and Chuck. They are innovators. What they have is a green technology. Doesn't break down. It's the speed is just like anything 2010 or better. The greatness about it is that it would allow for it to be put in every urban school and each child to have one desktop per child. So you can go into a school.
Desktop computer?
Desktop computer.
Oh my goodness.
Because he came with the funding. And that was been the hardships of trying to get our kids connected. Because there's no money.
Globally.
Right. There's no money to put something massive like that in the school districts. But Ron, with Jim Hare, has a technology that could connect every inner city school to having a one-to-one desktop in each classroom.
And he knew what he was talking about on
it.
He was really, really excited.
Well, that was his next career. You know, Ron told me right before he died, that he didn't want to see what you see is what you get at 60.
Really?
No.
Okay.
No.
And he was 58 when he passed,
58.
Right? So young. But we'll... him
yeah.
young. And
well, that's what I tell the kids, you know, to give them just a little piece, because it's so hard. You know, the baby is 12, and, you know, Tanya is 34, so it's a big range, you know, of ages in there, is that they're lucky.
Now tell me, who sings in the family now? Do you sing?
Oh, Ron told me I was tone dead.
But do any of your children sing?
There's a couple of them that you know, can carry a note. Yeah, including Tanya.
Oh yeah, Tanya did.
Yes, including
that.
Tanya.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Her
mother sang.
Oh, Vicky did. She was in that singing group.
Right.
That's right. She was in that singing group.
So, you know, Tanya gets it for both ways.
My goodness. You know, it was a funny thing, because they all went to Northern High School. Where did you go to high school?
Henry Ford.
Oh, over on Evergreen.
Right.
Okay. And if nobody notices, this lady has the most beautiful hair. She has the kind of hair they sell. I mean, it's just gorgeous. First time I saw you, it was so far down your back.
Yeah, right. Ron was a hair man. You know.
It was just beautiful, beautiful hair. So we have a lot of show to go today, and we're going to go to a break now because I want to bring up Harley. So he could add into the conversation.
He was there from the beginning.
He was there from the beginning.
Ron the boy turned man, turned entertainer.
And we'll be right back, and we'll be back with your calls also.
To Jerry Springer's. I want you to know, ladies, my brothers and I, we do respect you and love you for all the things that you do. I mean, you take care of the kids.
You know, so many times I've looked at you, and it seems tonight I'm seeing you for the very first time. Maybe it's the dress you wear, or maybe it's the color of your eyes. All I know is you're standing in my love light, love light, love light.
I've never seen you looking so lovely like you do tonight. I've never seen you shine so bright. And I've never seen so many men ask if you wanted to dance. They're looking for a little romance, if given half a chance. And I've never seen that dress you're wearing, or the highlights in your hair that catch your eye. Girl, I've been so blind, lady in red.
You know, so many times I've looked at you, and it seems tonight I'm seeing you for the very first time. Maybe it's the dress you wear, or maybe it's the color. All I know is you're standing in my love light, love light, love light.
I've never seen you looking so lovely like you do tonight. I've never seen you shine so bright.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome back to our special tribute to Ronald Dean Banks of the Dramatics, husband, father, entertainer, and friend. And today I have with me Mrs. Sandy Banks and Mr. Harley Brown. Harley, how long have you known Ron?
Ron and I have probably been friends probably 47, 48, almost 50 years.
Oh my goodness. So you remember the little Ron Banks?
Right. We started off, Ron had a love for baseball, and I grew up on the North End, and we had a field called Big Boston in the Little Leagues when we were little. Of course, William Howard was there. We were about 7 or 8 at that
particular
time. Yeah, Ouija. Ouija. And Clifford Burson, which was Smokey's nephew, and he sung too.
Yeah, they were Burstons.
Right, the Burstons. Mm-hmm. And And then when we got through school, because Ron went to Hutchins, you know, Ron's love for baseball, he was a great athlete.
Yeah.
And I remember trying out for the team in the ninth grade at Northern, and there was Banks. And so, you know, we were just always running into each other. And then I finally, Ronnie, about 13, he had cut Inky Dinky Wang Dang Doodle.
that was his first little song.
Right. And he had, Ron was big in stature, you know, thick and good looking brother. And
what did they used to call him?
Well, he had 1,000 names for Ronnie. I mean, Ronnie was, we called him Bowtie, we called him Dark Gable. I mean, it's just his name changed as he took on different responsibilities. And,
okay.
And as he played the field as a professional singer, we never knew. I knew Ronnie had that personality and character, but he became one of the world's greatest tenors.
Yes.
Of all time.
It was pure.
And at that particular time, as I said at the funeral, he and I were at Northern Inn in the auditorium, and we used to watch a group called the Alpacas, and these were older guys singing. And
Alpacas, like the sweater.
Right. A friend of mine, Tyrone Stanton's brother, was in the Alpacas, and they had you know, the little white shoes that you wore then. I forget what you call them now.
The saddle oxfords?
And the white suits. And
oh,
we were
the
just.
White. Oh, white.
They are hush puppies back then. And it was just amazing to see the level of professionalism and how these guys vocally could express themselves. And Ron was just a big guy. And he sung first tenor. So, you know, when you see a big guy have that light voice, because he was very charismatic, even with his movement on stage. I mean, Ron could move his weight.
And it seemed like
sexy.
He'd go on his toes sometimes.
Right,
you know.
He could get on his tiptoes.
Bow-legged.
And, right, and he was bow-legged, too. And he was, you know, he was heavier up top, but he was thin at the bottom, so he was well-proportioned. And, man, you know, of course, very athletic. And so he was a total package for a chick magnet, as we would say.
So did you use him like
that?
Oh,
yeah, we had.
Well, you're a handsome guy yourself now.
Thank you. Well, I mean, that's why, you know, we were brothers and best friends. And I mean, Ron inspired me. So I saw Ron, even though he was probably one of the youngest members of the group, put the group that we had our first major hit, the Dramatics, together, which was, you know, from the beginning, there was Rod and Squirrel. Squirrel had sung with the Capitals. Mm-hmm. And there was Albert Wilkins, which we call Velo, who was older, and Larry Reed and Ron.
Yeah. So how did Ron put
well,
that
Ron,
together?
Well, you know, back then, which was really interesting because people had to make a decision whether you're going to go into singing, which didn't generate a lot of revenue at that time as it was going into the automotive industry. Because at that time, Detroit had the Lions. You can go to Chrysler's and Ford and, you know, and get a job right away. And so most of the guys, including myself, worked at the plant. And I think that, you know, they made some decisions. And Ronnie, at that particular time, said, look, I want a Ouija song with a group, and they were the Primes and the Sir Primes. It was Ouija and Clarence Johnson, who later became Champagne, the MC for the Dramatics.
Oh, okay.
And it was Clifford Burston, Michael Belcher, and Madison Hughes. They were in, and they came out singing No More Water in the Well. And Ron and I, we just laughed, and then Willie Ford sung with the Boyers, Bob, Fred Boyer, and Spencer Pace.
And that was funny because Willie is small in stature, but he has such a deep voice
throughout. And Willie and I have been together since we were four. And
really?
He stayed on Westminster and I stayed on Arden Park.
Okay.
And it just, you could see Willie, we call him Bear, and we still do. With, you know, he just had that big, heavy, but soft bass. And it just was a natural fit how Ron, and I guess back in 69, it was then Ouija and Ronnie and Velo and Big Rod and Squirrel. They were contracted. And then later, I guess Rod stepped away, and Larry Reed, of course, had stepped away when Ouija came in and Willie Ford came in. And that's when Ronnie said, man, I want you to listen to some things. And he had met.
Where did they practice?
Oh, it was in basements and outside and everywhere else. I mean, but the key to that is that Ron had the vision to be able to put this together, to create this sound with this young writer named Tony Hester.
Yes,
who
Tony
was
Hester.
Great. And he took a liking to Ron. And it was just amazing what you could take a person's thoughts and their concepts and you can bring it to fruition. And Ronnie put the people in that group and create that sound. Well, it was very unfortunate that, you know, after the first album, almost in the middle of the second album, Velo and Ouija decided that they wanted to be independent of Ron and go out on their own. And at that particular time, they were with Groovesville with Don.
Don Davis.
Don Davis. Mm-hmm. And they went to Don to try to get them to sign them separate of Ron.
Really?
And,
why do you think that was?
Well, you know, sometimes lead singers, see, Ron always sung first and second tenor and sung first lead. And Ouija, at that particular time, it was a thirst there because, you know, that Barry had left. And there were no groups coming out of Motown able to sign with Motown.
Oh,
and
okay.
What Ron was able to do is create this certain level of professionalism and had good business acumen, which made, and, you know, because Don Davis had Johnny Taylor and those guys,
yeah.
But they had never discovered, you know, at that particular time, everybody was local, you know, Chapter 8 was there, where Anita Baker came
right.
from. And then you had the Floaters, Larry and I, we sung, because I sang a little bit myself.
Oh, do you?
And they were there with, you know, the Floaters. And then you had the Enchantments.
So much history out of Detroit.
Well, and it was because of Ron's business acumen gave them the opportunity to start back up, because we were being killed with the Temptations and the Supremes and Martha Reeves and the Four Tops. But they were like 10 years older than us.
Yes.
See, they'll be hitting 70 in Aretha. And were they?
And the Dramatics never signed with Motown.
No. They were actually under the tutelage of Don Davis, and at some point with James Brown. You know, James helped a lot, Stax Records.
Really?
Yeah. And I mean, and everybody, it was basically Squirrel came in and put the routine, the choreography, and dress, and together they kind of, you know, manifest this, what you know as the Dramatic sound. And of course, what I was saying, Ouija was a cross between David Ruffin and Little Anthony and the Imperials. And so that sound gave them a professional sound. And so, you know, Ouija kind of got the big head and decided that, shoot, you don't need me. I can just sing and be successful. And as you see, as most entertainers, a lot of people can sing well, but that does not create success. It
right.
takes a lot of things to create
well,
that
I
kind
think,
of
Well, I think, too, that Ron had the ability to sing lead, but he sang so well with the group.
Well,
I mean,
right. Ron was a, you know, I tell everyone, Michael Jordan was the best player in the NBA, but he never had a ring till he had a team.
Absolutely.
And Ron was a team player. He knew how to, I mean, we were young, going all over the world, singing. And I mean, I took care. Forrest Hamilton was their real first manager. I mean, Chuck Underwood was there in the beginning. And then Forrest came out of L.A. Forrest, Chico Hamilton was his father, and Barney Hamilton from Starsky and Hutch,
mm-hmm.
the black guy,
mm-hmm.
was his brother.
Yeah.
Ron, of course, knowing that our friendship and I'd always been in business, sent me to, you know, to negotiate these things and do things for
yeah.
them. And so that's how I know, you know, the inners of what, workings of what happened all the way until Ron's death.
Well, when they got that first hit song, what was the response? What was the feeling? What was going on? I mean, how did everybody feel?
Well, me, see, and knowing Tony Hester, but you had to really know Tony. The creative side,
yes,
was really, and Ron's creative side, it gelled. And so Ron kind of, anything you do every day, you can project and forecast. So he just would have a big smile. Bruskay, what you thinking? And I'm listening. And it's one thing to hear a guy say something to you in an auditorium in school, and another to see it come true. And to see that the things that he said, he never wavered till his death. He made sure that, his music and the music, and Tony Hester was a great writer.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, he wrote about the black experience.
In the rain, didn't he write In the Rain?
I want to go outside in the rain. Hey, you get off my mountain.
Yes.
Baby, thank you for your love. What you see, Tony. What you see is what you get, and that came from Flip Wilson.
What you see is what you get. What you see is what you get.
And at that time, Flip was dressing up as a woman,
Geraldine,
and he was the first person. And so that what you see is what you get. And then you saw these five black kids singing this. It gave them national exposure.
So when they had to make that first leap to a national venue to perform or on national television.
Soul Train.
Oh, it was Soul Train?
Yeah, Don was, the songs that they, In the Rain, Thank You for Your Love, What You See is What You Get, Give a Toast to the Fool.
Oh, goodness.
I mean, those songs became, and not just in Detroit, but because they were from Detroit and because we went through the community, we were kind of regular. But when you got on tour and you went outside, you would see that they were treated like the Beatles, the mobs. I mean, the kids, especially the women, they couldn't. Ron had that light, fluffy air sound to his voice. And I remember when Eddie left the Temps and Otis called Ronnie to join the Temptations.
You for real?
Yeah, and we were at his house in the driveway when I first pulled up. And I said, man, what would you be thinking? He said, bro, let me tell you what we need to think about. I said, why would you think about that when you created your own entity? You would leave the things that you built and the direction that you set this on to go sing with Otis and them? He said, you're right, man. And when God always sent me there when, in scenes and times where he was grappling with things like that, and he made the right decision, because Eddie was a great tenor, and Eddie was from Alabama and he came to Detroit, but Ronnie was here and he was a great tenor. As
yes,
you listen to his phrasing and the way he, his vibranum and mine were alike, because I can sing now, but when I sing lightly, it's because of the way Ron taught me. We used to sit on his porch and he would say, when I'm by myself sometimes.
Again.
And that airy sound would come out. And I would say, oh, I got you. But you got to, take your time and do those things. And he could do it spontaneously, And so it's a shame that people sometimes know that greatness comes after death. And, you have to really understand that a writer... And I'm going through this. I went with this with the OJs, with Eddie and Walt, with Kenny Gamble and Leon Huff. They wrote for the love of money, but it didn't get out there until Walt and Eddie sung it.
Right.
You follow
right,
me? I mean,
right,
and the
absolutely.
Way they put the performance
yes.
on it.
Yes.
And so, writers tried to take all the credit, but, and through courts and battles, they're giving the artists some credit. And
that's true.
And the yeah. way that Ronnie would come in with the music. And, Oceans of Dreams. I mean, all of those things at that particular time, a lot of babies were made off of the records from the
Dramatics. But, I remember this one time I met Snoop. Ron introduced me, mm-hmm. because they had done
Doggy Dog World
and everything. And he said that his mother listened to him all the time. And the parents listen to it, so that's these young people. They know Ron. Them these were iconic.
Well, Ron got his appetite in vocals from his mother.
Oh,
Ron's mother is a great entertainer and singer.
She has one song.
Yeah.
Oh, she
Rains
does.
Is really a right.
Yeah, she's like a jazz.
Yeah, his father was a teacher.
Song.
and his mother, you know, and so, and the rest of his siblings, Brian, Mama, you know, he sung Michael, in the Five Special,
and Michael and Billy. He's a teacher.
Yeah, right. but I mean, but they were athletically inclined. Donna, they have the vocal capability. It was just the charisma. And the rest of the banks don't say I'm selling you out. The charisma was born in the special gift, and the lack of being shy was with Ronnie. I mean, yeah. Ronnie had, not just on stage, but off stage, had the ability to get you to buy into the things that he wanted to do. And that's how that magic happened. There are a lot of great singers.
Yes.
There are a lot of good singers, but in order to move through this industry, there was a dry period in Detroit. They called it the Motor City, but the Supremes had left, the Temptations had
that
left.
Early 70s.
The Four Tops, Duke was always here,
right.
But they didn't open up an extension of Motown to be able to get new artists to come through there. There was no feeder. And so it took, you know, it was that charisma of Ron that gave the Dramatics the push that it needed to open up those doors so they could get on stage and be seen by the world.
Gee, and Soul Train, I guess a lot of us remember when they were on Soul Train, everybody was excited because they weren't a neighborhood group, but they were like, we knew them, you know.
Well, these guys were, you know, all handpicked. Willie, you know, you had Melvin Franklin, and Willie was, you know, he was athletic. Willie was always in the ROTC when we were in school.
Oh, was he?
And he was always cut. He's still cut today, and he's over 60 now. And so, mm-hmm. I meant to tell you age, brother, but you know it is what it is. And actually, he had a very melodic sound too. Treat me like a man. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And it really went over well. And so, and you know, Squirrel was always, he sings a great baritone, and he kept himself sharp, and he kept the choreography.
Now, was he the one who became a teacher?
Yes, 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 okay. Yes. Squirrel is very intellectually astute. I mean, he's a very bright guy, and very loyal and dedicated. I mean, I love Squirrel too. He's been gone out of the group for some time. Matter of fact, I chased him 6 months trying to get him to come back.
You did?
Right, after the day that he left. I mean, what really happened, and it's so unfortunate that, and Ben Cosby was handling, was with Ouija and Velo and Dupree, and they had him out on the road, and Ron came to me and said, man, what are we going to do? I said, well, we got to, you know, get a lawyer, and I'll give him a subpoena and get him in court and resolve it. So he came back and got me one day, he and Lenny, and I went down to Cobo Hall and caught Ben.
Lenny Mays.
Ben carried a pistol. They were scared. I said, man, I'm not scared of Ben. So I went down there and subpoenaed Ben and said, man, he said, Harlan Brown, you know how Ben talks. I said, what's going on? I said, here, Ben, you don't have to come to court, man.
They got awarded today.
Yeah, and
Ron and them got away.
Right, right. And so Ouija and Velo reconciled and sold That's out right. for 47.5 mm-hmm. for the name. They signed over their rights to Ronnie Squirrel and Willie Ford. And
okay.
That's how that got settled.
Wow.
And so, you know, it's a lot of history here.
A lot of history.
And it's very... you know, I'm blessed, and I'm still hurt because, you know, Ron's death was untimely, and I didn't tell him goodbye, and you know, I was very hurt about it, and still, you know, it's a long journey because, you know, there, as I tell Sandy, you know, as African Americans, we have to know about the business of what he has done, and it's that brand of the Dramatics that's important, the legacy for his children and his wife.
Right.
And we have to continue that and capture that because then to get more bang for the buck out of it, you know. We just tend to let things, because we pass, die. And no other ethnic group would allow that when you look at the things that they accomplished. I mean, Ron and I, it was two sides, him, the business side. We were the first professionals to come back. I went through the school system to do shoes for kids.
Right.
And have the basketball.
Well, we did a basketball thing at Highland Park Community High School. I arranged that when I was at the high school.
Right.
And just some other things that Ron then would do. He would show up with all the dramatics at my classroom.
Right, right.
To, you know, get the kids to help promote things exactly. and stuff like that. He was just into that. And I'm going to say one quick story. You may not know, this was a few years ago. He had come over to, I was teaching at Southfield at the time. And he said, Bryn, I need to stop by for something. Always stopping by. And I had my acting class, my drama class. And they see this older guy. I said, he's a singer. And they said, oh, yeah, you know the kids think they nickel slick and everything.
Right, right.
Ron, he started singing in that classroom. The kids, their eyes popped open. They couldn't believe that here's this man with this voice.
Right.
And they were like, and they just had to stand up and start cheering.
Right.
Just wonderful. And his children, so down to earth.
Oh, it's oh, so beautiful.
So beautiful, because I taught Bianca.
Right.
Yeah. And just so down to earth.
And I don't think a lot of people knew that Ron had as many kids and that he put the time in, he and Sandy, to raise them. Yes. Where, you know, I'm proud when they call me Uncle Harley.
Yeah.
I look at him and I see Bianca. Sometimes when we're talking, it's like Ron and I, you'd be sitting up female Ronnie.
Bianca so much like
Ron.
Right.
And Tanya.
Right. And Tanya.
Like twins.
Oh, yeah. I mean, Cakes, and you know, when she was born, we called her Cakes. And I mean, she was a baby in the chair. I remember her first birthday. I mean, you go through the changes, and you see that they have become the lady that she is. I mean, she's
wonderful.
A perfect lady, and she represents the family very well.
Well, you know, we have a quick call. Jay is on the line. Hello. Good afternoon. Hello? Hello? I don't know what happened. Is it? Hello?
Ms. Perriman?
Yes, is this Scoop?
The Wise Reporter.
Hi, Scoop, how are you? You have a quick comment or question?
Yes, the brother is very blessed to this, all the things that he's saying, that I feel them. And knowing that when you got someone in your midst, he really absorbed in everything that he's saying. I feel that they are true. And for Ron to have came behind the temptation, because you know the 20 grand,
yeah.
Where that's where a lot of stuff, where it started at the Fox Theater, and then you know the 20 grand. Was where a lot of stuff jumped off, to where the temptations, the miracles, the deals, and then the dramatics.
That's right.
And Ron ended up, you know, was a young one, because he said that, you know, he was a young one. And I'm hoping that these young people that are in the industry today will understand, you know, to learn their lessons from who has been the forerunners.
Right, absolutely.
Right.
And you had Frankie Darcel on the other day, where sometimes, you know, on the weekends, they end up be matching up different groups. And what is your comment in regards to the Dells versus the Dramatics? And there was an album that was
right.
put out, wasn't it?
We were in Washington or Baltimore, and I think it was the Foreign Wars.
I'm going to hang up.
Okay, thank you, Scoop, for calling.
And I had to go down and tell the Dells, because they were arguing. They were saying, there's no way I'm going to open up for Banks, Brown. I'm not opening up for Banks. I got too many hits. I know y'all got a big album now, but I'm not doing old. And so Ryan and them, they would be in the dressing room, and I go back and say, man, let's let them, you know, close, man, out of respect for our elders, and not just, you know, argue. We know that you the big dog.
Let's
go in.
Yeah, I forgot all about
that. And so they would, Johnny and them would say, yeah, you took care of that, didn't you, young blood? Because they thought that I was younger than them, but we were all the same age.
Oh,
so, you know, and they said, Ron got this young guy out there. And he said, he ain't young. he Charlie Brown just through with you.
Well, we have a quick call from Jay. Oh, somebody's on the line.
Can you hear me? Hello?
Yes.
Hi, how are you?
Oh, fine. We're getting ready to go to a break.
I wanted to ask.
Well, we're getting ready to go to a break right now, though. We're getting ready to go to a break because we're going to a break and we're coming right back. Okay? Thank you. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. We're having a wonderful time here. And we have a very special guest, a young man that you may know who's joining Harley and I here. And we're going to, of course, have Sandy come back. But we couldn't have this show without R.J. Watkins. Hello, R.J.
Hello, hello, hello.
How are you?
Fine, how are you?
I'm fine, I'm fine. In fact, it was Ron who introduced me to you.
That's right.
A long time ago, and Ron kind of co-hosted your television show sometimes. You had late night entertainment.
Yeah, there was a time when Ron wasn't on the road, and Henry had received the job at 107.5 WGPR, being a radio job. And so Henry was my man.
Yes.
And so Ron was at home and he wasn't.
A lot of people had that Ed McMahon job. I was your Ed McMahon once too.
And so then, I asked Ron would he come in and sit in for a while, and he was there for some time, and we had a great time
together. Yes, I'm going to show a clipping from those times. Now, remember, everybody, there are people here who don't look like they did that time, you know, but I think we look better. And this is Ron co-hosting Late Night Entertainment.
Right.
And it was good to see Jennifer, too.
All right.
Okay, can we have that clip?
Here's your late night entertainment, R.J. Watkin.
I love that applause. That's great. And this is?
I'm Jennifer.
Jennifer. Let's hear it for Jennifer. So, Jen, you're not going to co-host this evening?
No, I'm not. I gave my job to Ron Banks. He's a very qualified man. And if I have to give it up, at least I'm giving it up to the greatest.
Let's hear it for Ron Banks. Thank you, Jen. So, Ron, you're back again with us this evening, huh?
Yeah. Seems like I'm starting to be up late many nights now.
Many nights now?
Especially with late night entertainment.
Are you complaining?
No, I'm enjoying it. I can't wait for the show tonight.
All right. Tell me, who do we have on our show tonight?
Oh, we got one of my friends that I was raised in the music industry with, the lovely female vocal stylings of Orthea Bonds.
Let's hear it for her.
Yeah.
Right here?
Oh, you're going to love her, man.
In the late night studio?
Yeah, you're going to love her, vocally and personally.
Okay.
She's a very talented person.
What else do we have tonight?
Let's see. Of course, we're going to be talking to Brenda Perriman, who's the director of the play that I'm even doing here, RJ. The 5 minutes. Yeah, it's going to be hot.
Let's hear it once again for Brenda Perriman.
Land on brand. Come on.
And who else?
Downtown Anthony Brown.
Anthony Brown.
Yeah, be a clown here. Right here today.
Right here.
Oh, yeah, we're going to have fun tonight, Jay.
It's going to be a ball.
That's right.
And we might do something with video or something.
If we have the time, we have a special video for you tonight. I won't tell you exactly who it is, but I'm quite certain that you'll enjoy it.
Let's hear for our surprise video.
Surprise video featuring every one of you. Definitely.
If we have time.
If we have time.
If we have time.
We will find time.
So, Ron, I guess our next line is what? I'll be back with more of our show after we're from our sponsors.
Definitely. It's time to pay some of those bills.
Let's pay some bills.
All right, man.
We'll be back with more of our show after we're from our sponsors.
Late Night Entertainment is being brought to you by Colonial Merchandise Mart in downtown Detroit on State Street.
Back with more of Late Night Entertainment. And tonight, as Ron told you earlier, we have a very exciting show.
Yeah, definitely. I think the combination of our guests this particular evening will definitely entertain each and every one of you.
Each and every one of you?
Yeah.
Ron, you was telling me something earlier about the baseball bat before in the dressing room. You were telling me how you were, I think, on East Davidson somewhere where we grew up at.
Tell me when I was a kid?
Yeah, this big guy had a bat. No, he had a knife.
Yeah. You know, we always try to emphasize when we're talking to the youth of our community, never get involved in any bad activities. So the guy had a knife. I didn't know whether he was trying to butter some bread or what it was. And I had this bat. I was coming home from a game.
Uh-huh.
And I showed him the difference of a butter knife and a bat. And I guess you know who won. Because you see, I'm sitting up here on Late Night Entertainment. I don't know where he is. Oh, but if you are out there, bro, sorry.
No, nothing personal.
Yeah, I just thought you were a ball. Okay.
All right, listen. I love that. It was
Hey,
it was
man.
But listen, we're going to bring out our first guest.
Okay.
I understand that you're going to be involved in something else.
Right. She's the director of the first play that I went off into theater, mm-hmm. and it was a great experience working up under her, and she's very talented in direction, as well as I think you've even experienced yourself with the Court of Love.
Oh, she's a genius.
Need we say any more?
Let's bring on Brenda Perryman, okay?
Let's bring on.
So, Brenda, I understand that the 5 minutes returns.
The 5 minutes is back again by popular demand. Anyone who missed it before will get to see Mr. Ron Banks and his Oscar-winning performance.
Oh, get me an Oscar. Cut it out.
So tell us a little bit about the... tell us, first of all, why... What made it come back again?
Well, several reasons. It was so good, and then you did a last year, mm-hmm. and what ended up happening, so many people saw the special in rerun that...
thank God for the rerun.
Thank God for the rerun. So many people saw it in reruns. They were asking us for tickets all the time. And
right. And that happened a lot when I would be out in the public here, definitely at home here. And what happened, too, I think, is the time, and when we started it, it was like in a workshop form. And the cats that I was working with, they were kind of really breaking me into theater. And by the response of the public, as well as we even wanted to do it for them again. But this time, we come into you live and in living color, and we're going to have a lot of fun with you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Tell me, how did you get Ryan involved in such a play, Brenda?
Well, I've told the story before. It should be patented by now.
You were jogging down the street.
No, you were jogging down the street. Oh. He was running down the street, and I was at my front door, and I said, Ronnie, jog in place. I want you to read the script. And he said, okay, Bren. So I took him the script, and he read it.
It's an interesting story, man, because now I have a lot of chicks say, Ron, would you run in place, darling? I want to talk to you.
I was always good for a good line, RJ. But anyway, the play itself is so good, and I think Ron had a number of reasons for being interested in it.
Oh, definitely. I wanted just to see, first of all, if I could, you know, branch off into that and into theater and into acting, period. But, I think we've been acting all our life.
I have to say, Ron's, he's a very good actor anyway.
How do you know, Jay?
He came to see the last performance of the 5 minutes. We'll not talk about it.
Well, thank Brenda for that. Because she didn't want me to answer that question.
Right. Thank you, Brenda.
You're welcome. Good
night. Listen, back with more of our show. I have to work for my sponsors.
Okay.
Because if I would have answered that.
That was just some of it, and there's more to it, and gosh, that was almost 30 years ago. 30 years ago, and RJ's up here talking about you didn't know I was cute. Well, you know, that was about a long time ago. But we also have a clipping in there of Ron actually acting in the play, and he was a great actor.
Of course.
Yeah, he was born to act. Ron was born to entertain.
Yeah. He had the charisma. He had the look. He had the body language, fast, you know, that's what I was telling you.
Yeah.
Right. As children, Ron and I would have adult conversations. and I mean, it helped me because I was like the little cute shy guy. And he brought that out of me to make me, you know, into the businessman that I became. And I explained that to him that, you know, buying a hospital, you know, unheard of, blacks. Those are the things that Ron taught me to step out there and do the right thing. Not try to be right, but do what was right. And that created, I mean, I walked into MCA Records and, you know, here we coming from Detroit and we young.
Yeah.
I mean, we're running everything. Responsible for getting them there and responsible for getting them back home.
Right.
And bringing them back to their parents or their wives or whatever. And never lost anyone while we were out on the road. And he taught me that. I mean, he just... That was the business side of him, the spiritual side of him, and he was a man first. Ron was a man. I mean, and
great heart,
and a good heart. And the heart was a Christian side of him.
Yes.
Very much. Family. Yes, Sandy put on Facebook last week, and it just brought tears to my eyes because he was standing in the wings, and he was getting ready to go on stage, and he was like, he was by himself, and he was praying.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. I mean, it. You know, of course, I can be. You know, I can color things because when you're there and you're living it and you're seeing it. So I didn't sing on stage in a uniform with them, but to in the preparation of that, being a part of that, then I understood where his heart was. And I saw him spend timeless nights, hourless nights, getting gigs, as we called them, trying to get promoters. We had buses to load up, and take these kids out. And it was just a job. And he, never gave up, to his last breath.
Right.
He was always trying to feed entertainers, trying to get them woven into the music industry because Tony was writing and producing and Don was executive producer. Next thing, here's Don, Ronnie, and next thing, here come LJ. They want to be writers and producers and publishers.
Oh, goodness gracious. So, RJ, what were some of your best memories of Ron?
Ron, he was just a real guy. There was times that we would talk until 3 and 4 in the morning about certain things that was going on in our lives. And I was with him when he met Sandy. I call her auntie. And that's what I call her to this day. She's auntie. And the night we met auntie, and Ron was really in love at first sight, to tell you the truth. And I had my little two cent to do with that, a little bit. Did I, Sandy? Kind of massaged it a little bit. But I think we were at Thomas Hearn's house. Is that right? Oh, L. Carl's house. Oh, nobody. Somebody's house. Okay, L. Carl's house. Yeah, somebody's house.
L was around then, too.
Yeah, and we met, and it was like, I gave her her stage name, which was Auntie, and that was... Code name. Okay.
Oh, Lord. Let's not get into that. That's another thing we cannot We cannot talk about.
That was so long ago.
It was a long time ago. Fun. A lot of water fun. Under the bridge and all of that. Yeah. But I would watch you and Ronnie kind of play off of each other on television.
He was, again, like I told Holly, he was fast on his feet. He was a great co-host. He would keep it going. Sometimes, if I run out of something, he'll come with a punchline, or I'll say something, he'll take me somewhere else, or I'll take him somewhere else, and it's all fun, it's all clean, and he was great at that, without offending anyone.
Right.
If he did, he'll turn it back around and make it work.
Well, not only was he a sportsman, he was a sports fan.
Oh, no
baseball,
question.
Baseball, football.
Anytime a game be on, Ronnie would be in front of the television with a plate of food. That's probably why he gained weight later on. And not as active.
Who didn't?
Right.
He really liked, and I remember he brought Tommy Hearns over to the school and everything.
Oh, yeah. As I said at the funeral, we did, and this is coming up on our 30th reunion, Tommy and I, with Sugar Ray, 1981, when he fought Ray the first fight. And we started in preparation of that in 1980, We Are the Champions. And so we cut that and had Tommy sing on it right before he fought Ray. And Tommy was just the creative side. And I started First Round back in 1980 with Ron, Tommy, and John Yap. And we did the first, BK and Marty had the 20 grand on the boulevard. Because when we first started, we was at the old 20 grand. And we did closed circuit fight television. We bought closed circuit in that night of the fight, 1981. It's 30 years ago.
Wow.
And we did.
How did it go? Did y'all make any money?
Yeah, I made $45,000 back then.
Wow, yeah. And that was a lot of money back then.
The Dramatics
was new.
Well, we were getting $25,000-$30,000 a night at the Grand, at the old $20,000, and then when Bill and Marty bought the one before Al went into the Entrepreneur there,
the Latin Quarter,
right? That we were, because then we would go from the Christmas holiday. It would be two shows a night. And it would sell out, and we did. Tommy pull up in his limo and his
Lord.
I mean, we was young; we had it going on.
I mean, you know, I think if all of us remember all the money we went,
right. I mean, it was
Sundays.
Yeah, and I mean, at the old $20,000, where the Jays would show up, Marvin Gaye. It'd
be a jam session.
Last night I was thinking back, and it was Jimmy Carter, and the Dramatics did the entertainment at Cobo Hall, and that was the first time that I got a chance to see the champ come out. It was Muhammad Ali, and I was in the back coming out, and I said, Ali, and he said, hey, man. I said, look, welcome to Detroit. I'm Holly Brown. I represent the Dramatics. He said, I'd like to meet them boys, and I brought him into the dressing room. And that's how we got a chance to, meet Muhammad Ali. But it was, we would have never gotten into those kinds of political ventures if it had not been, for Ronnie. I mean, Ronnie was always out, like you said, in the school system, always out in the public.
He was visible. Always visible.
And his hand is closed, can't nothing come in. And he kept his hand open. And I think that the community, not just the music community, but the school system, like I said, only other time that I know that entertainers have given back here is I had a, from the Lynx, we did a show with Dennis Edwards and the Temps with Ben, and we raised $60,000 for McGregor Library. Mm-hmm. And that's the only time that I've never seen Diana Ross or any come back here. And knowing that Detroit has major problems, to see how they can reorganize and help. So I salute Ron and I salute Dennis. And,
but things are yet to come in his name.
Well, that's why we're here now, because we're not going to let Sandy, his wife, and I, we're not going to let this die. That everyone else will feel the sincerity that we're speaking about. And, the dream.
And RJ, before I bring Sandy back up here, I want to ask you, what do you believe that Ron's legacy is?
Wow, Ron's legacy. I think Holly summed it up. I said he just by being right to others.
Yes.
Doing right, being right, regardless. When it's all over, at the end of the day, at the end of the conversation, Ron's gonna make it right.
Yes. Yes.
What did you say?
Oh, no.
He's gonna make it right.
No question. Yes.
I mean, that's some things that I can't even talk about. That he made right.
Right,
when
right.
Things were coming against me, he made things right.
Yes.
No question.
He was just the kind of guy, you know what I mean? If he's your friend, he's your friend.
Yeah, he
if he's not
guy.
Your friend, he's still your friend, if that makes any sense.
It's just funny because he'll just stop by, your house. Like Ron never called. I mean, once in a while he'll call and say, I'm stopping by. He'll stop by with one of the kids or something like that, or just to run something by you.
He loved the children.
He loved the children.
We did the Christmas album and all the children and all the squirrel and all that.
And the picture, up the stairs.
Right. Mm-hmm. And I mean, we got everyone that was involved with the Dramatics, and if we left out anyone, it wasn't our fault that they didn't show up for it. But if you buy the Dramatics Christmas album, will see the Dramatic family. And at that time, I was, opened up my home. My Ron said, look, brother, we need to do that. I said, come on, man, do what you got to do.
Ron would invite people to your house because he sure invited me to house.
No question. My house was open for Ronnie 24 hours, 7 days
a
week.
I
sung on that album too, Oh, the Days Before Christmas.
Really?
He said, man, I want you to do something. I mean, so, his love was genuine. It was nothing fake. About Ron Banks.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Nobody can tell me.
If he had to check you, he'd check you.
Right.
Then he's going to hug you.
Right.
Let's do take care.
But that laugh of his.
Yeah.
I mean, he didn't care about being loud either. He didn't care about that. And then as far as that album Two of a Kind with the Lady in Red on it.
Yeah, with he and LJ.
He was so proud of that.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, he was so proud of that because my copy was a copy I got from him. He said, I just want you to hear it. And the mastery of that and The Lady in Red was he had never heard The Lady in Red done by Simply Red, the original artist.
Right.
Ron took it and...
Oh, he took it to another level.
Another level.
Yeah.
An absolute another level. Right. So he was such a musician.
Yeah. Sure. Yeah, he was... See, if you notice his... body language and how he points his finger. Yeah. And I mean, you would never think that it was rehearsed because it was just natural. Exactly. And it happened that way.
Exactly.
Even when Ron was a great and could have been a professional baseball player.
Really?
I mean, he just, you know how life is full of balance? His balance was there in his steps and his walk with God. He was on stage. I mean, Ronnie would come out, and when they would do "Be My Girl," and we would start the tenors, and some was worked off between LJ because LJ is a great vocalist too.
Yes, he
is. And he had that high range, and it brought the true level of perfection of what you could get in Motown, what you could get out of Detroit, Michigan. He represented Detroit well as a vocalist. LJ Reynolds, Ron Banks, I mean, Lenny was a great showman, great second tenor. Squirrel had, you know, the best choreography.
But Lenny could dance his buns off.
Yeah.
He was such a great dancer.
Yeah.
I mean,
he projected, and they all projected well. Willie Ford, I mean, you came out with Me and Mrs. Jones.
Yes, yes.
You know, Billy
yes.
Paul did it, and then they put their
spin on it.
Well, you know, when I was Wenzel Kelly's teacher,
yeah.
I mean, I was really young when I was his teacher. I mean, really young, everyone. No, seriously.
About the same age as Wenzel.
No, I was like 3 years or so because I just finished student teaching and everything. And he always, as a high school student, said, I love the dramatics. I want to be a dramatic.
Right.
And for him to get that opportunity to be a dramatic.
Right.
Something. So I want to bring Sandy back up here.
Yes.
Sandy, come on back.
We'll go
to a quick break.
We'll go to that clip. Acting.
Oh, the acting. Can
clip.
We
roll that clip?
Yeah. Let. Okay. We're gonna roll that acting clip and bring her.
Take a little time out. Thank you, baby. Thank you for your love.
Are we? And Brenda Perryman and Ron Banks. Go ahead. What you want to tell me, Brenda?
Oh, I just wanted to tell you that the play opens next Friday at McGregor Library Auditorium in Highland Park.
Right.
The address is 12244 Woodward Avenue. And tickets are $4 unless you're a senior citizen, and it's $2.
How much are tickets? How much are tickets for me?
RJ, $8, $10. Or two mules.
Okay. I'll probably come up with the two meals faster than anything else.
I'm sure
but
you
since
would.
We're talking to Brenda, we must. Can we get a shot of this on camera one or two? Who's going to shoot this? Two.
You got my shirt.
The Court of Love. The Court of Love.
I didn't know when.
Let's hear it for the Court of Love.
Yes, baby.
Now we can't forget about the back of the shirt. Well, come on back, camera two. We can't forget about the back of the shirt.
Oh yeah, no, we can't forget about that.
Now, Brenda, can we come in tight a little bit, camera two? Where it says WGPR TV 62.
RJ, your name's on everything.
Not
we
really.
Own it.
Listen, if you listen to the Court of Love every Friday,
yeah,
we come on at 12, and the Court of Love is on about 1. And Brenda Perryman, she directs the Court of Love. Last week, we had a very exciting case.
Oh, we certainly did. We had a young man who went into a topless bar with his
friends. And when he got in there, he saw his lady friend, who was a college student. She was dancing. He noticed a dimple on her derriere.
Okay.
And she had told him she taught modern dance at night. She didn't tell him she did modern dance.
Ron, what was your statement when you heard about that?
It's probably just a normal response from any other caring man. If I ran into the bat, and definitely from then on, she would be a dancer. Mm-hmm. Dance without music, baby.
Breakfast,
lunch, and dinner.
Dance.
You could stay in the top 10. I mean music.
But listen, we're going to take a look at the film clip.
Yes, in this film clip, Ron and two other members of the group are in the dressing room.
Gloria?
The two other members are Eddie Bell and Gil Billingsley. They're in the dressing room with him.
And then
two ladies come in, and they're looking for the star of the show, and just so happened...
It's not Ron Banks?
It wasn't Ron Banks. You know, and this... Well, you'll see what happens. The reaction to Ron Banks, it shows Ron doesn't charm every woman.
Okay, let's take a look at this film clip, okay?
Okay. It'll never get to your head. Because once you do, it'll take your mind, body, and soul, Jim.
That must be time, Andre.
It's about time they showed up.
Hey, fellas, hey. What can I do to help looking young ladies?
Oh, I don't believe it. The 5 minutes right here together in person. I only see three.
Well, the others will be here shortly. But until they arrive, perhaps I can be of some assistance to you.
We've been big fans of yours for a long time now, ever since you all brought out Stuck on You back in 62.
Oh, you ain't old enough to remember that, is you?
Where is Tyrone? I came back here to see Tyrone Dixon.
I said he is not here at the moment. But until they arrive, perhaps I can give you my autograph and number. Say, baby, what is your name?
Sarah Jane, nigga. Now, when is Tyrone gonna get back here?
Look, you.
I'm sorry, ladies. The show is about to start, and you're welcome to come back and have an autograph or two, okay?
I don't want no autograph. I just want to see Tyrone Dixon.
Well, whatever the hell you want, he ain't here. So would you please leave?
Well, excuse me. Come on, girls. Get out of here. We ain't got to put up. Nathan Pinkney.
In the flesh.
Cleophas Moore. And Stan Williams. My favorite group when I was a kid, the 5 minutes. Look, I'll be back later, and I'll be in the third row room for you all. It's so nice to have you all back together again.
Thanks very much.
Oh, you're quite welcome.
Say, what's your name?
Linda.
Well, lovely Linda, you be sure to come back now.
Okay.
Okay? Yeah. You fine, sweet thing, you. Man, I could have slapped him, little silly cousin.
Just like old times, Nate's grabbing for the women and Tyrone got him standing in line.
Yes, just like old times, all right. And His Royal Highness is late as usual. Man, where the hell is he? Now, I'm telling you, we ain't going on late on account of Tyrone. If he ain't here, we starting out. Now, I mean that thing.
Okay, so that was Augustus Williamson and Eddie Bell. Eddie Bell is a native of Highland Park, and he was in that play, and that was Gloria Johnson and Kay Buckner, who were the ladies in this. And that was back in 1983, late 83, when we did that in 84. So you all saw that play, didn't you?
Yes, I did.
What was so funny, the one funny story I got to tell from that play was Ron was so used to singing on stage, right? And I told him, I said, you can't deliver your lines to the audience. You got to talk to the person on stage, because he was doing everything. He was turning, yeah, baby, you know,
right
to the front, you know. And sometimes we get women there in the audience who, you know, they had to scream. And I don't believe in participatory theater like that.
Right.
But it was just a great experience. And he did other plays after that.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. So, Sandy... Harley, this has been wonderful. You know, remembering our friend, your husband. Tanya, thank you for calling in. And everyone, I'm going to have Harley back to tell some of those stories again so we could hear some more.
Right.
And everything. But Ron will live on.
No question.
He will live on, and thank you all very, very much, very much.
Tanya, I love you. And to the rest of the children that are here with us, they know that Uncle Harley loves them.
Uncle Harley, and you have anything to say?
No, other than thank you for this. I didn't think I could do it.
Oh, girl.
But I'm glad I did.
You're a champion. We love you, Ron.
We love you, bro. Definitely love you.
You're the best thing in my life.
Best thing.
I never felt so good when you add a little rhyme.
Best thing.
Lucky for me that you came along. Just whispering a love song. Then you captured me. And lady, it was harmony. Yes, you're music to my heart. Heaven right from the start. Don't ever take your love from me. Sweet ecstasy, baby, what you do to me. It does magic. I love you much too much to let you go. I need you so.
Best thing in my life.
You are.